James Yee, it's great to have you here.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
You know, you and I spoke on the phone in 08, and I know my brother represented you in, what was it, 05 or 06?
No, that was earlier than that, back in 2003.
2003. And you are a national figure in the sense that you were the chaplain, the Muslim chaplain at Guantanamo, and you were arrested and tried, or were to be tried. I guess it didn't get that far for some crimes against Guantanamo. Want to talk about that?
Yeah, let's go back to that. I was serving as the U.S. Army Muslim chaplain down at Guantanamo Bay, the chaplain to the prisoners, the, quote, alleged terror suspects that were held there, and 170 who are still being held there. That was back in 2002 and 2003. And as a chaplain, I was sent down there, of course, with, in my mind, the priority of ensuring that the prisoners down in Guantanamo had religious rights, that they could fully practice their faith, Islam, even as prisoners being held by the U.S. military. Mm-hmm. So I did a lot of work towards accommodating religious practices, ensuring that the Islamic call to prayer is made over a loudspeaker five times a day to enable prisoners to pray in the proper times. I worked to get meal schedules adjusted during the month of Ramadan, the month of fasting, so that prisoners could fast from dawn until sunset, mm-hmm. not having, without eating. Mm-hmm. I did things like ensuring that every cell in Guantanamo had an arrow painted pointing towards Mecca, so that the prisoners would be able to pray in the proper direction. So I worked towards accommodating as many of the religious practices of the prisoners as I could.
But you were at the time a Muslim.
Yes, I'm a Muslim convert. I was actually raised Lutheran growing up in New Jersey and converted to Islam back in 1991, shortly after I graduated from the United States Military Academy, West Point. I'm a West Point graduate.
Mm-hmm.
So down in Guantanamo as the chaplain and in working towards upholding religious rights for prisoners and providing religious counsel to prisoners, I became quickly aware of really how prisoners were being treated down there. And in my mind, it was prisoners being persecuted for their faith.
And you were outspoken
Muslims.
About it.
And I raised concerns. I raised concerns on behalf of the prisoners about specific treatment, specifically those that dealt with religious persecution, mm-hmm. To my chain of command. And actually, when I was down in Guantanamo, I thought that went very well in my favor, and believe that my chain of command valued the input that I was giving.
Mm-hmm.
But let's talk about some of the things that some of the questions and concerns that I raised. I thought prisoners were being persecuted for their faith, especially when I heard stories like prisoners being put in what you might call a satanic circle.
What is that?
In an interrogation room, where an interrogation room had a circle marked on the ground, and in the center of that circle you had this satanic star shaped symbol that represented Satan, you know, that pentagram shaped symbol. And they would—
This has nothing to do with the Islamic religion.
Nothing, but the interrogator would take a Muslim prisoner and put that prisoner in the center of this satanic circle and attempt to force that prisoner to bow down and pray, like in the form of the Muslim prayer, where Muslims prostrate, put their forehead to the ground, while the interrogator would scream at the prisoner that Satan is your God now, you know, not Allah, not God the Almighty. That was done because it was understood by these interrogators, these intelligence officers, that Muslims hold fast and strong to the belief in one God, the core belief in one God, and they attempted to break prisoners from that by using this satanic this diagram, right? That was just one way. But, you know, there were other ways in which, you know, I heard prisoners being religiously persecuted from, you know, prisoners who had their beards forcefully shaven. I mean, many prisoners practiced the conservative interpretation that it was a religious obligation upon Muslim males to wear a beard. Sometimes the army would force these prisoners to would forcefully shave the faces of these male prisoners as punishment or to intimidate them. There were other things from the Quran being desecrated in Guantanamo, soldiers throwing the Qurans on the ground while the cells being searched, interrogators taking the Quran into an interrogation room in front of a shackled prisoner, stepping on it, stamping on it, sitting on it.
What was the point?
They were trying to essentially break prisoners from their faith, which was...
demoralize them.
Their strength, and you know, demoralize and humiliate them. This was a concern for me as a chaplain. I mean, I'm down in Guantanamo. I'm serving the U.S. military. I'm serving our country in a way that preserves that First Amendment right to religious freedom for all people. And, you know, I learned very quickly in the chaplain school that chaplains fight for the religious rights of those service members who serve our U.S. military, for federal employees or any employee who may be working on a military installation, as well as anyone who might be imprisoned or incarcerated by the U.S. military. And of course, that was the situation down in Guantanamo. And it really disturbed me because, you know, our country was founded on this idea of religious freedom. You know, the pilgrims came to our country, landed on Plymouth Rock. Why? Because they were in search of a place where they could practice, even if it was a puritanical form of their faith, freely. But nowadays, in this day and age, in Guantanamo, you have the opposite. The members, the prisoners in Guantanamo who were being held there were actually being persecuted for their religious beliefs.
Of course, this was known to the command.
Yes, it was known to the command. And as I indicated earlier, I thought that my input was valued by my chain of command on the detention side of the operation. Mm-hmm. Because during that time in Guantanamo, I received a stellar officer evaluation report. I received actually two official military awards, joint service awards, we call them. And I was actually recommended for a third higher award that I would have received at the end of my tour. And then I received what you might call R&R, rest and relaxation. Mm-hmm. I was allowed to leave Guantanamo after having been there for 10 months, knowing that, you know, I would have 2 weeks to visit my family back in Seattle, Washington, and in the Seattle, Washington area. Mm-hmm. Knowing that I would have to return to Guantanamo, finish the last 2 months of what would be a full year of duty, and then complete my tour in Guantanamo. But when I got on that plane from Guantanamo, landed at the Jacksonville Naval Air Station in Florida, hoping to catch my connecting flight back to the West Coast, but that didn't happen. When I landed in Jacksonville, Florida, I was swarmed by immigration and customs officers, counterintelligence officers, naval criminal investigators, NCIS, and FBI. And these customs officials would first say that I was carrying some suspicious documents that they took out of my backpack when they searched my bag. And be mindful, I was the only one actually singled out off the plane that day and singled out for search. But they said I was carrying suspicious documents. Out of nowhere, these intelligence officers appeared, and then they were making these spurious claims that I was carrying classified documents. And then they ran to that particular base commander there in Jacksonville, got a search warrant, complete search warrant, and then later the deputy commander in Guantanamo would sign off on an arrest warrant. And then I was actually arrested in secret and thrown in prison, first in a cell there at Jacksonville, and then later moved to Charleston, South Carolina, known as the Consolidated Naval Brig, where our government, under the Bush administration, was housing what was termed U.S. citizen enemy combatants. I was thrown in solitary confinement there, accused of these heinous crimes, spying, espionage, aiding the enemy, mutiny and sedition, and was even threatened with the death penalty. And
oh, my goodness. And you're at the time, you were, what, a lieutenant?
I was a captain in the U.S. military. Remember, I'm a West Point graduate, an officer in the U.S. Army, and I come from a family that is rooted in the military. My father served in World War II. My younger brother is also a West Point graduate. And my other brother is a U.S. Army physician, a doctor, serving right today at Fort Hood. And when they're throwing these charges at me like that and had me locked away in solitary confinement, my military attorney, you know, was advising me, you know, you need to consider hiring, retaining a civilian attorney. And that's when, through the help of my friends and my father, we found your brother, Mr. Eugene Fidell.
Yeah.
And
well, he was the right guy.
He was the perfect person to provide me with legal counsel and you know, what I needed at that time was an expert in military law, and indeed, he is such.
Yeah. Wow. That was, you must have been pretty ticked off, or at least amazed.
It was perplexing on, you know, the way I was being treated. I mean, okay, I'm a Muslim chaplain serving down in Guantanamo Bay. I'm a Muslim convert. After 9/11, you know, I can perhaps expect people with a lack of knowledge to perhaps question me about things, but to the extent that I would be thrown in jail, then carted off, locked away in solitary confinement, accused of these capital crimes, and even at times subjected to what's known as sensory deprivation.
Where
I was shackled in these chains, I had these blackened out goggles on my eyes, these devices over my ears so I couldn't hear or see. That was something that I knew about because it was a form of treatment that I recognized down in Guantanamo as the prisoners who were being in process. And that was quite frightening because, you know, our commander-in-chief, President Bush at the time, said that, you know, these prisoners in Guantanamo, they don't have rights. And as I saw them subjected to sensory deprivation, and then now I'm in the same shoes being subjected to this.
Did they give you Miranda warnings?
I thought I was being going to have all my rights taken away. Miranda. Actually, in the military, they're called being read your Article 32 rights, which is equivalent to Miranda.
Yeah.
You know, the right to remain silent, the right to an attorney.
Yeah.
And when we see this, I mean, the show Cops, you know, when we watch it on TV, when someone gets arrested, the police officer says, you know, you have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law, you know. We have the same form in the military. It's called Article 32, Article 32 rights. They were never read to me. I was never read those rights. I recall after being interrogated by the FBI and NCIS and those intelligence officers down in Jacksonville the day I was arrested, when that Navy officer decided he was going to arrest me, he never read me any rights. He called over the guards. They shackled me up, handcuffed me, put me in a car, and I was driven to a hospital.
Who was responsible for this? I mean, who are the people who put this kind of thing in motion against you?
I think there were several people. There was, for one, there was a colleague of mine down in Guantanamo who was a liaison officer from the detention operation where I was assigned to the intelligence operation. And for some odd reason, I would learn later, he had some hostilities towards Muslims. He was behind creating this idea that Muslims down in Guantanamo were subversive, or that we were a sleeper cell. And him, along with an investigating officer, would several times attempt to get the command to approve of, you know, a full-blown counterintelligence investigation on me down in Guantanamo. And when they eventually succeeded, this is when they had this sting operation set up when I would land back on U.S. soil. What's interesting is through speaking to an investigative journalist who covered my story very in-depth. This journalist at the time was with the Seattle Times, and he did a featured story on my case that ran on the front page for a week when I was when I separated from the military. Mm. And after talking to him, he told me that the plan was actually not to arrest me on that particular day, but the plan was to follow me because they feared that I was going to pass sensitive information and classified documents to some Al-Qaeda operatives in the United States, and that they were going to catch me doing that. But when all these intelligence officers swarmed me on that day and had my bag searched, and this reporter told me that they sensed that I had caught on to their plot, and that they needed to arrest me right away. And they came up with the story that I was stealing classified documents from the base, when indeed, you know, I indeed didn't have anything nature.
So, you know, the things that were happening in Guantanamo, you know, about religious freedom and all that, were those things ever cleared up, or is that continuing?
Well, after I was arrested, they never replaced my position of Muslim chaplain down in Guantanamo to the prisoners. They did later bring in what they call now a cultural expert, a contracted civilian employee who has, I imagine, a very large six-figure salary to basically say, yes, the military is doing the right things that are culturally appropriate. I've read many articles, and he's referred to in the media as this guy named Zach. But certainly there is no one down there to actually advocate on behalf of the prisoners' rights, specifically religious rights, and that's really the job of a chaplain. So,
yeah. Well, back to your story. So now you're in jail, and I remember it was an extraordinarily long period before you were released.
I was there for 76 days. I was in jail for 76 days. I was in solitary confinement. There were times in the very beginning when I was in that cell for 24 hours without end. It was through the help of my legal counsel, through your brother, who fought just to get me 1 hour of recreation out of that cell. I was held initially incommunicado without the ability to contact my family. And my family actually didn't know in the beginning of what had happened to me. I never showed up at the airport to meet my wife and daughter. My family learned of where I was when the story broke on September 23rd, 2003, that the Muslim chaplain from Guantanamo had been arrested and was now in this maximum security prison in Charleston, South Carolina, on the news. And that's how my family actually found out where I was, when they saw me on the news, a featured story of that day.
But shortly thereafter, you were released.
I wasn't released for, several days later.
Oh, 70, okay, you know, okay. Because I remember there was a letter to the White House, wasn't it?
This was, yeah, after I had been in jail for quite some time, weeks, and Gene, my attorney, sent a letter to the White House demanding that I be released. And this was after it was determined that the military was not going to be charging me with any of these capital crimes, that they would try to hold me accountable for what they called mishandling classified documents. And the letter laid out that, mishandling classified information is not an offense, even if it was true that I had done that, that would warrant someone being locked up in prison for a former CIA director that was found guilty of that offense. An advisor to President Clinton, Sandy, I think his name was Sandy Berger, was found to have violated that offense, and several others. And it's not an offense that you get thrown in jail for. It might warrant a reprimand if true. But in my case, it wasn't even true. I hadn't mishandled any classified information. And I don't know if that letter had any direct effect on my release, but very shortly after that, I was released from prison. And the military attempted to still prosecute me on those lesser offenses, and in which my legal counsel did an amazing job. And we demanded from the government, from the U.S. military, that they bring forth any evidence that they had to show that I indeed was mishandling classified information, and it was not, and all the charges would be dropped. The charges were dropped. I was reinstated. My record was wiped clean. And it really wasn't that long before I would tender my resignation from the U.S. military, resign with an honorable discharge, and even upon separation received a second U.S. Army Commendation Medal for exceptionally meritorious service.
What a disconnect.
So today I'm a U.S. Army veteran. I've served in two of our nation's conflicts, in the aftermath of the first Gulf War, Operation Desert Storm, and now more recently Operation Enduring Freedom as the chaplain in Guantanamo.
Anybody ever apologized to you, James?
Never received an apology from anyone in any official position of leadership. No apology from the military, from the U.S. government. But I've had many, many good-hearted Americans and many, many good-hearted people from around the world send their apologies for the way I was treated.
What a travesty. Incredible story. Yeah. I know you've been in the media for a while over this, but have you written a book about it?
Yeah, a lot of that media stemmed from me deciding after my ordeal that I would document for the sake of history,
sure,
exactly what had happened to me. I authored a book entitled For God and Country, Faith and Patriotism Under Fire. It was published in 2005, in late 2005. And it really goes into my journey to Islam, becoming a Muslim, growing up in America, attending West Point, and then how I became the Muslim chaplain in Guantanamo, depicting what goes on inside Guantanamo or has gone on inside Guantanamo, and then the trash ordeal that I was put through for raising concerns about prisoner abuse, potential torture, cruel and human degrading treatment.
What a shame. This is a shame on our country. So, your conversion to Islam, you were married to an Islamic woman, is that what happened, a Muslim woman?
Yeah, actually, while I was doing some training in hopes of one day becoming a Muslim chaplain in Damascus, Syria, and at that time I was doing my studies, my religious studies there, as well as teaching English as a second language, through one of my students in the English class I was teaching, I would meet my wife, my future wife. The student was my wife's cousin, and I would marry a Palestinian woman born and raised in Syria, who has since naturalized and become a U.S. citizen.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and that's another, the citizenship. I mean, at the time of my ordeal in Guantanamo, she was still a legal resident here with a green card, not a U.S. citizen, and, you know, we had our application in, you know, for her to become a U.S. citizen. And after, you know, me going through this entire ordeal, having our lives turned upside down and being on, you know, a no-fly list after my ordeal and all the security surveillance and concerns, we thought it would never be possible that she would ever get her citizenship. But in June of 2006, she received her U.S. citizenship.
Good.
And, you know, took the oath. And I remember it was in the spring of 2006. Actually, it was in June of 2006, I believe it was, and the immigration department actually offered to allow her to take her oath on the 4th of July, you know, with many others who like to take
sure,
their oath and,
sort of symbolic,
and become
yeah.
citizen on Independence Day, but yeah. She said, no, I want it right away, I want it now, you know, and the following week she took the oath and became a U.S. citizen.
So. You were not a Muslim at the time you graduated from the academy.
No, I wasn't. I graduated from the academy in 1990, and I converted to Islam in the spring of 1991.
And that was before 9/11.
Before 9/11, yes.
So tell us about the.
By the time I became a chaplain in January of 2001, you know, just 9 months before 9/11, I had been Muslim for what? 10 years. But my journey to Islam, I really didn't know much about Islam after graduating from West Point. I never had a course in comparative religion or even in Islam at the academy. But shortly after I graduated, I met a college student in Washington, D.C. We were engaged in some dialogue, discussion about faith. So, you know, I we'd call that interfaith dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
It was the first time I actually heard something about Islam. And, you know, at that time, you know, having been Christian, being raised Lutheran, Islam was, hearing something about Islam was something that I actually immediately rejected. And when I was posed with this question, well, what do you know about Islam? And my answer was nothing other than that it's probably misguidance, right? And the challenge was then put forth in front of me, how could I judge something without knowing anything about it? And that actually made sense. How could I judge something if I don't know anything about it? So I took it upon myself to get a book from the bookstore, a basic book on Islam that I pulled off the shelf. It was called An Introduction to Islam. Started to read, hoping to learn something about this faith so I could be better able to debate. But I quickly became intrigued with finding that much of what Muslims believe were things that I myself already believed in as a Christian. A lot of people, you know, tend to think that Islam is here and Christianity is here. But actually, when you look at the doctrine and the two faiths, they're very close. I learned, for example, that both were monotheistic religions. They both hold fast to this belief in one God. Right? As I learned more about Islam, I saw the names of Abraham and Moses, David, Joseph, Noah and his ark. The story of Jesus are all found in the Quran in Islamic traditions. I was surprised to learn that Muslims also believe in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, which is a very integral part of the Christian faith, something that I grew up on, learned in Sunday school. And so in becoming Muslim, it was a very intrinsic part of my life that didn't go away. And to this day, of course, I still believe, as a Muslim, that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. And then you had other concepts of forgiveness, the afterlife, heaven and hell. And then, of course, I would learn more about Judaism, the third of the three Abrahamic faiths. A lot of the traditions all interweave. And it was very easy for me to become a Muslim.
And you're still an active practicing
yes,
Muslim?
Yes, very much so. But actually, when I became a Muslim, I had no intention of being what you might call a religious Muslim.
Yeah.
I was Christian growing up, but I didn't never viewed myself as a religious Christian. And at that time in my life, actually, I didn't go to church every Sunday as I did as a youngster. And when I became a Muslim, it wasn't my intention to become a religious Muslim. But it was my deployment in the aftermath of the first Gulf War, being in Saudi Arabia, and when the conflict was done, there was an opportunity for American Muslims, me being a new Muslim at that time, to visit Mecca. And I was still a very young Muslim, so to speak. I had only converted to Islam about 6 or 7 months earlier. Still in my mind, I had this impression that, you know, I can be Muslim because I believed in one God. I believed in the lineage of the prophets. But that going to Mecca as part of a minor pilgrimage, so to speak, I would be different. I would stick out because in my mind, Muslims were either black Americans, African Americans, or Arabs. That was my impression, like it is of many people.
Sure.
And it was an inspiration to see that on this particular day in Mecca, you know, there were people from all over the world. First large group of Muslim pilgrims that I saw were surely Asian, either from Malaysia or Indonesia, with physical features like mine. I met Muslims from Africa, from Russia, from Europe, from the Arab world. I met Muslims from America on that particular day. I met a couple of students who were actually studying Islam in Medina, which is Islam's second holy city. Mm-hmm. So that was a very eye-opening experience for me. I actually refer to it as a Malcolm X-like type experience. And that display of diversity, which was instilled in me as an American growing up, you know, in this country, which is often called a melting pot of ethnicities, was inspiring for me. And that led me to question, why in the U.S. military, as a Muslim, aren't there any Muslim chaplains? Indeed, we had Jewish chaplains, we had Christian chaplains, but there, that time in 1991, there were no Muslim chaplains, and thought this was it would quickly become a growing need as I saw the number of Muslims in the ranks sure. growing at that particular time, yeah. and set out to hopefully one day become a chaplain.
And that did happen. I mean, you became a chaplain, but were there others who were becoming chaplains, Muslim chaplains?
At that time, I didn't know, but the first Muslim chaplain to come into the ranks of the U.S. military happened in late 1993, early 94. That individual now is actually a lieutenant colonel, highest-ranking Muslim chaplain. When I entered the ranks as a Muslim chaplain in January of 2001, there were one or two Muslim chaplains serving in the Navy. There were one or two in the Air Force, and there was even a larger handful in the U.S. Army, about 10 to 12 or so at that particular time. January 2001, though, I was the newest Muslim chaplain, and after 9/11, quickly became a point person, handling media requests from journalists who wanted to cover the story of what it was like for Muslims serving the ranks following the tragic attacks. And whatnot.
This was before you went to Guantanamo.
Before I went to Guantanamo. And actually, I received a lot of recognition in that immediate aftermath of 9/11. Doing media interviews, holding training sessions, seminars, training troops on Islam and the Muslim cultures, troops that were deploying to Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I gained some
sensitivity training.
Yeah, educational. So, and it makes sense because if troops are going to deploy to a Muslim country or Muslim land, they should know something about the people there.
Avoid alienating.
So I gained some recognition during that time, and I think that is what landed me that job in Guantanamo, that assignment. And I was handpicked to be the Muslim chaplain in Guantanamo.
Your choice or somebody else's?
Oh, I was handpicked. It came from high up.
High up.
Okay. So I was taken from my signal battalion at Fort Lewis and sent to Guantanamo. Mm. But that was my experience, and that led to me documenting my experience in a book, and then going on a massive speaking tour in the years following Guantanamo, leading all the way up to the historical election of Barack Obama.
Ooh. Let's see. Tell me about Barack Obama. Where does he fit in all of this for you in terms of the election and after the election?
Yeah, well, you know, I think it was in 2000 and let's see, the historical election of 2008, but I think it was, you know, early 2007 or so when he announced that he was going to run for president. He was very strong on the position that he wanted to close Guantanamo Bay, wanted to ban torture.
You were already out of the service.
Without exception. Yeah, I had left the military in 2005 and had already published a book and was advocating for the closure of Guantanamo on a daily basis in my work at that time.
What was your work at that time?
Lecturing, being invited all over the country, universities, colleges, community colleges. Interfaith communities were inviting me to speak about the issue of Guantanamo. It was very hot at the time, as these many cases were going up under the Bush administration, mm-hmm. to the Supreme Court.
Yeah,
you know, it was a big issue. And when Obama announced his presidency, he campaigned strongly on the issue of closing down this prison camp, banning torture without exception. And getting rid of the military tribunal system, the military commissions system, as they're formally called, under the Bush administration. Getting rid of this system, which was looked at by many legal experts as a system that wasn't fair and just to try terror suspects down in Guantanamo. Obama campaigned on those issues, and I thought that was great because I knew what was going on down in Guantanamo. My life was directly affected by what has happened in Guantanamo. And I immediately supported Obama in his campaign for president, so much so that that I decided to run in the state of Washington where I was living to become a delegate, a national delegate.
To the convention?
Pledged to Obama, to the Democratic National Convention,
okay. All right.
To help this individual become
president,
sure. So that I can see in my lifetime this Guantanamo being closed.
Yeah.
And
that was the reason?
Yeah.
That was
and I campaigned on that reason and was elected at the local precinct caucus, and then at the county caucus, the congressional level, and that got me one of the very few slots that states have to become a national delegate. And I attended the historical Democratic National Convention in August of 2008, first time a major political party nominated an African-American as their candidate for president. And my pledged delegate vote went to Obama. And I also had the honor of attending the inauguration in January of 2009. And I believe I was still in Washington, D.C. following the inauguration when Obama, 2 days after he was inaugurated, took office, signed the executive order to close down Guantanamo within 1 year. He also signed an executive order that would close, that same executive order actually would close down the secret CIA black sites, and he signed another executive order that would demand a complete review of how prisoners were being treated in Guantanamo. Actually, I think the night of his taking office, he actually suspended the military commissions process, the legal process. And these things were great moves, in my view.
Great, but why take a year to close a town? Does it really take a year to close a town?
He was giving himself a year, but that year, January of 2010, has long since gone. And Guantanamo today is still open, still operating, and actually President Obama has seemingly done a 180 on the issue of Guantanamo.
Why?
Guantanamo is still open. He He's actually recently, in my view, institutionalized indefinite detention, saying that there are prisoners who will be put on trial, that there will be prisoners who will be released, and that there will be prisoners who won't be put on trial but are too dangerous to release and therefore will stay imprisoned without charge indefinitely. This, like I said, is a complete 180 backtracking.
What happened?
And
what happened? I mean, there's been an explanation of this?
I see these decisions being made as a politician. As a politician, yes, there's some difficulty in closing Guantanamo because there are members from opposing party and as well as members from his own party who do not want to see Guantanamo closed. So as a politician, yes, there are some difficulties. But as commander-in-chief, he has the authority to close down this prison camp right now. And something struck me from a former Secretary of State, former Chief Staff, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff in the U.S. military, Colin Powell, who can be quoted as saying that, you know, if it was up to him, he wouldn't close Guantanamo tomorrow. He closed it this afternoon, right?
Well, that's why I asked, you know, why did it take a year to close it? I mean, he could have closed it right away as soon as he was
sworn in. But he hasn't. The problem is he hasn't closed it. And so many people that I meet today actually come up to me and say, President Obama's closed Guantanamo, right? But no, there's still 170 people still in Guantanamo. And the most recent news is that President Obama has decided that he will try the terrorist suspects, those alleged to be behind the tragic attacks of 9/11, down in Guantanamo under military commission, not under federal courts, as he was advocating when he was campaigning. This system of military commissions is a far less system of justice than what we have in our federal courts. Federal courts have been time-tested, tried, and since 9/11, convicted many suspects, defendants on terror crimes. I don't think this is good for the reputation of the country. It's going to be viewed as perhaps illegitimate, and it's a system that seemingly is designed to ensure guilty verdicts. People are concerned that because of how many of these prisoners were put through torture, that a lot of the evidence is tainted, and that these defendants could perhaps walk free. But subjecting them to some type of judicial system, which will essentially guarantee a guilty verdict, does not, in my view, bode well for the reputation of the United States with regard to upholding the rule of law and standing our ground on human rights. I think that's a mistake.
Did he make any changes? President Obama? I mean, did the 170, you say, that existed at the end, was that smaller than the number of people who were there?
That's a great question. What changes really has Obama made on Guantanamo? And in looking at the entire situation as a whole, you know, really, I don't see any major changes being made in Guantanamo. I have seen some positive things from Obama with regard to outreach to the Muslim world. He did this a great speech in Cairo. He's visited several Muslim countries, I believe to include Indonesia and Turkey. But in terms of foreign policy in the Muslim world, there hasn't been anything concrete. A lot of talk, a lot of good outreach and words. He's done a lot of outreach to the American Muslim community right here in the United States. Very well publicized Ramadan, breaking of the fast dinner held in the White House, every year, 2 years now. He's appointed a prominent American Muslim attorney who was initially in his inner circle, in his inner legal circle of advisors, and then later appointed by Obama to be the envoy to the OIC, the Organization of the Islamic Conference, a very prominent member of the American Muslim community. And he sent representatives to many of the major Muslim, American Muslim organizations at their national conferences. So there's been a lot of good outreach, but Guantanamo, There's a lot to be said. There's a lot that needs to be done there.
What about
foreign policy.
What about the American military? Where do they stand? Are they advising him to keep it open? Is he listening to them? Is that what's happening here?
Well, he has kept on Secretary Gates as the Department of Defense, who was serving at the end of the Bush administration. Secretary of Gates, has basically, from what I've read and what I've heard from him, is saying that, you know, he's been following what Obama wants and his guidance. But I don't think it's the military telling him to keep Guantanamo open. I think the conservative side of the elected officials in Congress and in the Senate are pushing to keep Guantanamo open.
It's not a credit to the administration. What do you think is ultimately going to happen
here? Yeah, well, one of the things Congress did do was they've actually blocked President Obama from using any military funding to move prisoners to the United States for any reason.
That's not too long ago.
He still has other funds that he can use to bring prisoners to the stateside for the trials. But it's clear that conservative politicians don't want any of these trials being held in the United States.
It's because they favor the tribunals, the commissions.
I fear that Guantanamo is going to be a permanent fixture with our military. I fear that's going to happen. One of the things to look at is if prisoners are ultimately convicted, given life sentences, where will they carry out those sentences? In my view, there's no reason why they couldn't be held in the supermax of our federal state prison system here, where we have, for example, those who were convicted for the 1993 terror bombing, right? And other terrorists, criminals who have been mm-hmm. convicted. But it seems as if they perhaps might be held in Guantanamo for a lifetime, and that will entail keeping Guantanamo open forever. What is known is that very solid permanent prison facilities were built in Guantanamo after my time. So you have these now permanent prison type facilities and structures down in Guantanamo Bay.
Got every indication of lasting.
Yeah.
But let's talk about what you're doing today with CAIR, C-A-I-R. What is CAIR?
Right, CAIR. CAIR is the Council on American Islamic Relations. CAIR is the largest Muslim American civil rights group in the country. We have over 35 chapters. I am the executive director of the New Jersey chapter. We have a fivefold mission. We defend the civil liberties of the Muslim community. We work to enhance the understanding of Islam. We work to promote dialogue. We work to partner with other entities, with other organizations who also advocate for justice and mutual understanding. And we do anything that works to empower the American Muslim community, encouraging civic engagement, for example. And those are the things we do. I'm the director of the New Jersey chapter. I recently took on the position last summer. And it's really an extension of the work that I've been doing. Following my Guantanamo ordeal and military service, I began work in human rights and advocating for the closure of Guantanamo and speaking out against torture. And now I'm continuing to do work in advocating for civil liberties, religious rights, freedom of speech, things like equality. And since 9/11, the American Muslim community has suffered tremendously. Perhaps being looked at by many as potential suspect before being considered a patriotic American. Even like myself, who had graduated from West Point and served the U.S. military, none of that came into play. But what was looked at was my religious faith, and that I could more likely be a Muslim terrorist than a patriotic American, and was thrown in prison for that. So I was a victim of what you might call Islamophobia. You know, this fear, irrational fear of Islam and Muslims. And much of that is due to a lack of knowledge. But some of it is due to people who are pushing this agenda, spreading misinformation about Islam and how Muslims, American Muslims, want to overthrow the U.S. government and replace to the U.S. Constitution with this thing called Sharia.
Is the Islamophobia, is it something that is, involuntary, or are there people who create Islamophobia intentionally, willfully, for some other purpose, where they're not actually afraid, but they have another kind of agenda, motivation?
Yeah, I think it's twofold. I think the vast majority of people in America are reasonable people. But the Muslim Americans are still a very small minority. Out of the almost 300 million people in America,
yeah.
A moderate estimate of Muslims in this country is 6 to 8 million. Only 6 to 8 million. So we're still a very small minority. And people have a lot to learn about who we are as a community and our faith. And that's why we actually encourage our community, the Muslim American community, to get civically engaged, to be involved in many things throughout all sectors of our society, so that we can build relationships, so that we can, demonstrate to our neighbors, who we are as a community and the many good things we have to contribute to our country.
But are there people out there who are willfully working against?
But there are people who we term Islamophobes, who actually are out there intentionally spreading misinformation about Islam and about Muslims.
Why?
And a prime example is what happened with this recent controversy of last year, the Park 51 Cultural Center in Lower Manhattan.
Oh, sure.
AKA the Ground Zero Mosque.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And what had happened here is a Muslim American whose children in New York City actually attend the Jewish Cultural Center in New York City, in Manhattan, and saw that this Jewish community center was a great thing for the community and wanted to mirror that project and make a similar cultural center. And it would be sort of like the same thing, a Muslim cultural
mm-hmm.
center. And he purchased a building about four blocks from Ground Zero with plans to turn it into a nice cultural center that would help revive the area. Now, if anyone who's taken a tour of Ground Zero,
yes.
that first street where Ground Zero is on is thriving because there's so many people coming, tourism, to see the site of Ground Zero. But two, three, four blocks away, all that area is still economically dead. Four blocks away, this individual purchased a building, hoping to revitalize this area. You can't even see Ground Zero from that building he bought. But some people put forth this idea, particularly I think someone named Pamela Geller, who is known to be an Islamophobe and has said very hateful things about Islam and Muslims, put forth this idea that this building that Muslims have bought is on Ground Zero, and that Muslims are building a mosque on Ground Zero, and was then termed the Ground Zero Mosque. How could Muslim Americans build a mosque on hallowed ground of Ground Zero? But it's not on Ground Zero, it's just in that vicinity. And this caused a lot of stir. But I'll tell you, the correct response is that, look, 9/11 happened to everybody. There were Muslims who were killed in 9/11. There were Muslim firefighters who responded to 9/11. And if you go to our national website or even my Care New Jersey website, you will find the link to public service announcements that we developed that feature a New York City firefighter, a Muslim American, who was a first responder on 9/11. These public service announcements feature a clinical pharmacist who was a first responder on 9/11. The fact is that 9/11 happened to all, and it was a tragedy for American Muslims as well, and American Muslims had nothing to do with those tragic attacks and the almost 3,000 people who died on that very day.
So I'd like to get sort of take the temperature of the groups involved through you, through your eyes.
Yes.
So in the one case, you have the Muslim community, however big they are in the U.S. How are they? In other words, are they feeling oppressed? Are they feeling that they're getting a bad deal here? How are they reacting to mm-hmm. you know, the reaction against 9/11.
Yeah. Overwhelmingly, I would say that the American Muslim community feels that we have gone through some significant challenges since 9/11. Of course, right after 9/11, there was some immediate backlash, but that backlash actually started to snowball. Our organization, CARE, has actually tracked civil rights violations, civil rights complaints, discrimination against the Muslim community since 9/11, and every year since 9/11, it has increased.
In quality or quantity or both?
Certainly in quantity, in terms of the number of complaints.
Mm-hmm.
Our organization actually began to thrive after 9/11 because of the number of complaints. And we would love to be put out of business where there would be where there are no civil rights violations, there are no civil rights concerns that the American Muslims would be concerned about, and put us out of business. We would love for that to happen. But the truth of the matter is, we've only grown bigger because of the problem.
So why is the problem bigger? I mean, what is happening in the other constituents here, the people who are paranoid about the Muslim community? Why are they getting worse? Why is Islamophobia getting worse? What is happening?
Yeah, well, in terms of the number of civil rights complaints, they have gone up every year. But actually, in my view, in the years following 9/11, as we got further and further away, things started to, in my view, improve in some sense. Things seemed to quiet down, even though the number of complaints increased. And perhaps that was because of our effectiveness as a civil rights organization.
Could be, yes.
And people knew to come to us, and so therefore there was a forum, there was a channel that people could actually complaints.
Let me offer this thought, you know, at the beginning of it, you know, the suicide bombers and the whole suicide kind of approach on things, flying planes into buildings and the like, that seemed to be derived from a religious motivation. Or let me put it this way, it had religious trappings on it.
Yeah.
And done in the name of religion by people who, you know, had their own reasons. But I think the public saw a connection there between Islam in general and what these people were doing. And that was the original reaction. That was the early reaction. And I imagine that organizations like CARE try to disabuse that reaction.
Yeah, it certainly,
explain it doesn't
certainly
really work that way.
Certainly part of our mission is to enhance the understanding of Islam, and we try to do as much as we can to properly educate people about the faith. And no doubt when those individuals hijacked those planes and took them into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon, they also hijacked our faith, Islam. Islam categorically condemns killing of innocent people across the board. And when you go to any website of any American Muslim organization, you find the actual religious ruling, what's known as a fatwa, a religious ruling that condemns terrorism, that condemns the killing of innocent people. The mass majority of Muslims worldwide are against violence. So I think around the world that is because actually more Muslims have been killed by Muslim terrorists than people who aren't Muslims. And Muslims have suffered from terrorism more so than non-Muslims. So actually around the world, the vast majority of Muslims actually are against terrorism and violence. The Muslim world, though, are they angry and upset with how the United States carries out its foreign policy? Sure. Even Muslims here in America, most Muslims here in America also see an imbalanced approach to American foreign policy in the Muslim world. And a lot of that plays in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, where it's the perception of Muslims around the world and in the United States that the United States isn't a fair and honest broker in that Palestinian-Israeli conflict and lean towards Israel. So in terms of foreign policy and the anger that emanates out of that, Muslims have problems with American foreign policy there. But in terms of supporting violence against innocents, no. Across the board, I would say the majority of Muslims around the world are against violence.
Do people begin to understand this now? Is that entering into the recipe somehow?
This is what we try and educate people and try and bring forth statistics and reason to show that. But still, media plays a large role in shaping people's perceptions. And usually when you see people acting out their anger against America or against the West, in demonstrations, that gets captured on news cameras. So you still a large, a significant perception that, you know, Muslims are violent people. Here in America, I think we've made great strides. I think CARE has made, and CARE and other Muslim organizations have made great strides in getting our community civically engaged. I mean, in 2006, we saw the first American Muslim elected to Congress, Mr. Keith Ellison, the 5th District in Minneapolis, was the first Muslim American elected to Congress. And he also made some news when he said, look, when I get sworn in, I'm going to do my swearing-in ceremony, take the oath on the Quran. That actually was controversial. Because a congressman from Virginia named Virgil Good said, you know, Keith Ellison announcing that he's going to do his swearing-in sermon on the Quran is contrary to the values of the United States, right? That congressman is no longer a congressman, you know, has since been defeated. But what did Keith Ellison do? How did he respond? A very savvy politician. He went to the Library of Congress. And he borrowed from the Library of Congress the copy of the Quran that was owned by Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson himself owned a copy of the Quran, 2-volume translation. I think it's quite evident that he was a student of the Quran, and that shows in how the Constitution was developed to allow for religious freedom of all people.
Is Islam changing, you know? I mean, the West was really not watching it very much. Starting maybe 20 years ago, people got more interested, such as you, and learned more about it. But I don't know if people learn enough or study it enough to be able to say how it is dynamic. Mm-hmm. And it is changing in the way, you know, in terms of engagement, as you say, civic engagement.
In terms of the communities, yes.
In terms of assimilation, for example, mm-hmm. I mean, that's a natural process in, you know, in every religion, assimilation. Yeah. So I just wonder, in the U.S. and elsewhere, I mean, for example, you know, there's an issue about burqas in France.
In France, no doubt, yeah.
A big issue, and that's not over yet. And there's an issue in some school district in Michigan, in Dearborn, where the Muslim community was upset that the school menu included pork, and so they asked the school board to change the menu, and the school board wouldn't change the menu, so they all ran for the school board. And now now they control the school board. And
yeah, so this is called civic engagement. Yeah, I mean, in France, we saw recently the law take place that bans burqas and the full face veils. I look at this as going to the extreme. First of all, in my view, that French law that bans the burqa and the face veil is discrimination against women. Who is government to tell women what they can or can't wear? I mean, the fight and struggle for women's rights has been long and hard fought. Generally, we view Europe as actually being more liberal than the United States.
Yeah.
But in this instance, here, in my view, they are violating the rights of women by dictating to women what they can or can't wear. You do have a difference in Europe than you do in the United States. The Muslim communities in Europe seem to be more ghettoized and less assimilated, more of the lower social economic status. And as I mentioned, finding more difficulties achieving equality and success. And for that reason, you find more problems within the community protesting that kind of treatment. I mean, we saw it here in the United States with the black community, struggling for equal rights. When we look at our civil rights movement and here in the United States, how much of that history dealt with riots? I mean, Newark riots and whatnot, carried out by the inner city communities to struggle to get equality. I mean, I think that's sort of what you're seeing in Europe. And Muslims in America seem to be much more affluent, and studies have been done to analyze the demographics.
Well, America is a more mobile place, yeah. Upwardly mobile,
so
possibilities.
I would actually say that the story of American Muslims in this country has actually been one of great success. I think we're moving very quickly with regard to political participation. I mentioned earlier, in 2006, we had the first American Muslim. We actually have two American Muslims now serving in Congress. The second is a man named Andre Carson in Indiana, was elected not long after Keith Ellison. So I think we're moving very fast. My own experience being a delegate at the Democratic National Convention learned that every presidential election for the last four or five cycles, the number of Muslim delegates has increased. And we had probably 30, 35 American Muslim delegates at the Democratic National Convention.
So what about assimilation, though? I mean, I come from a family that was a Jewish family, and over generations, they pretty much assimilated, intermarried, became less religious. Mm-hmm. Is this happening in the Muslim community in the U.S.?
Oh, sure. Sure. I would say, actually, probably say that there are more Muslim Americans who don't go to the mosque every Friday than there are that who do. That's actually a sector of the Muslim community that I'm trying to tap into with regard to the civil rights work. A lot of my support comes from the Islamic centers and the mosques, but I know there's a lot of support that I can get for the work that I do from those who don't attend and that are not necessarily religious.
Mm-hmm.
By and large, Americans are very successful professionally and are generally very affluent. Mm-hmm. and educated. So I think that's a story of success. But one of the things that makes America great is it allows for people who want to be as religious as they want and as non-religious as they want, as long as neither are violating the rights of others.
Right. I wanted to, Terry Jones in Florida.
Pastor Terry Jones, an evangelical pastor, actually last year announced that on the anniversary of 9/11, was going to carry out a Quran burning at the site of Ground Zero, right? And that caused a lot of controversy, and actually high-level government officials got involved. Generals, I think the commanding general of CENTCOM, Central Command, and the head of the military got involved, saying, "Don't do this. This is going to inflame emotions overseas and would put troops in danger for burning the Quran, something that is deemed highly, highly disrespectful, deplorable by Muslims around the world."
That sounds like a legitimate concern.
And you know, as Muslims, we uphold the respect and the honor and the reverence for the Quran,
yeah.
What we consider to be the literal words of God.
Yeah.
It's very similar to what you find in Judaism.
Yeah.
When you go into a Jewish synagogue, where do you find the scripture?
Yeah.
It's in what is called the Ark, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes it's under lock and key, and sometimes it's only the rabbi who can script the actual scripture. And that's done out of respect, out of reverence. For the Holy Scripture, the Word of God, and in Islam we have that same principle.
Sure, I remember the cartoons in Denmark that resulted in some violence. So if you burn the Quran, you can predict that it will result in some violence somewhere.
So Pastor Terry Jones actually, he reneged on his promise, thankfully, and decided he wasn't going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But more recently, what he did down in Florida at his church is, he held what he called a trial. He put the Quran on trial, and he found the Quran guilty. And then he burned the Quran. He had someone burn the Quran in his church. And it was videotaped and it went viral. And it caused riots overseas. People rioted against UN buildings and whatnot. And both protesters and non-protesters were killed, have been killed in these riots. And it did stir a lot of anger and emotion.
How do we avoid this? I mean, on the one side, shouldn't do that. On the other side, people could probably be better off not reacting so violently.
True. From the Islamic perspective, of course, there is no justification for people to react violently, even when that occurs. From standpoint of free speech, someone has the freedom to draw a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad or of Jesus, as has been done, or burn the Quran and as a matter of free speech. Are they morally wrong? I would say yes. Are they ethically wrong? Yes. Just because you have the right doesn't make what you do right. This is an issue that actually I'm dealing with actually in New Jersey, where on the anniversary of September 11th of last year, Terry Jones didn't burn the Quran, but there was an individual, a state employee of New Jersey who worked for New Jersey Transit, did go to the site of Ground Zero and burn pages of the Quran. And that was captured on television, made the news, and as a result, New Jersey Transit fired that employee. Now, that employee was doing it in his own individual capacity, not in uniform.
But he knew it would be provocative.
He did it to provoke tempers and emotions. He got fired. The ACLU of New Jersey came to his side and filed a lawsuit.
Interesting.
Filed a lawsuit to get his
wrongful termination.
To get his job back. So there's a lawsuit now against New Jersey Transit to get his
it's a weighing and balancing
to get his job back.
Competing interests.
From the CARE perspective, and we are a civil rights organization, we support this individual's right to burn the Quran as a matter of free speech, but we also condemn exactly what he did, mm-hmm. burning the Quran, as a way to insult and offend, more than a billion people around the world. What he did was morally wrong, and we consider it a hate speech. We don't believe he should be given a platform. We believe that people like that and like Terry Jones should be ignored. Does it give us the right to respond and react violently? No, it doesn't. And so we also condemn any violence from the Muslim community in response. There are proper ways to handle. And I think he should be ignored. If we are going to react or protest, it should be done peacefully. And it can also be done in conjunction with our interfaith partners who also see what these individuals do as being morally wrong.
Is the press doing its job or is it fanning the flames?
Sometimes it does fan the flames. Sometimes it does fan the flames. But I tell you what, the Muslim community can help the press do its job better by being proactive. And building those relationships with media so that when there are stories, media outlets, journalists, reporters will cover our side and our voice as well. I mean, I think for the most part, journalists, they want to do that. They want to do that. And by making ourselves available and making ourselves accessible, they have better opportunity to do that. One of the things that I've been trained on, will be working to implement in my own organization, is a communications department that regularly monitors news reports, both on television and in the newspaper.
It's like the Anti-Defamation League.
Yeah, so you monitor it so that you can point out to editors the imbalance of the coverage. And when that is done, usually these individuals will respond back with, would you write us an op-ed so that we can show
you
your
voice? If you want it evenly balanced, help us balance.
Yes, and they offer the opportunity for us to get an op-ed. Whereas a lot of times if we just send an op-ed in, it may not get picked up. But, and then again, it's a two-way street. We need to have people in the community who are willing to take that time, sacrifice that time, to sit down and write an op-ed. And, for example, the issue that on this Quran burning, free speech versus, you know, being morally, being a morally wrong, you know, I'm working on myself an op-ed that
balances.
We'll hope to get published.
Well, you,
You know, as this as issue proceeds in the news. So
all your life experience points, you know, it makes you very qualified to do this job. So what's the next job? Is this a permanent lifetime job?
No, I don't know. I don't know, but I do know that with, you know, the controversy over the Ground Zero Mosque last year as an election issue, I think the snowball of resistance against Islamic centers and mosques being built all across the country, one of them in particular, Murfreesboro, Tennessee, which was recently profiled by Soledad O'Brien on a CNN documentary entitled Unwelcome, The Muslims Next Door. I think with the Quran...
Was it a positive story or a negative story?
It actually portrayed how, you know, the community was really against the building of this Islamic center. The growth of the community has actually lived there peacefully, but as it grew, needed a bigger place. And as they purchased a place to build a larger facility, the community came out and started to protest.
Mm-hmm.
It was demonstrations. It turned to vandalism with a spray painting of their new sign, and then the actual sign was sawed in half, and then it actually turned to arson, where some people set fire to the construction equipment on site. So it really brought out some of the bigotry that's involved in that case. But this is actually happening across the country, from California and Temecula to Michigan to a situation in New Jersey, which I'm dealing with, where a local township has quickly changed its zoning laws to prevent a community from building an Islamic center. You know, to Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and other places around the country. So there's a massive resistance to Muslim communities building Islamic centers and mosques under the guise of traffic concerns or safety. But I think there's a lot of discrimination out there in that regard.
Well, and you keep seeing indications of it. For example, the anti-Sharia laws, Oklahoma, what's going on there?
A number of anti-Sharia legislation. A number of states have submitted legislation that is essentially designed to ban what's called Sharia. Now, Sharia is essentially Islamic law. It's a religious law. It dictates how Muslims should live their life. You know, for example, you know, when Muslims pray five times a day, that's dictated by Sharia law.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't impose upon others who aren't Muslim that they have to pray. No, it dictates to
but
Muslims.
Not necessarily inconsistent with other laws.
No, it dictates to us that we fast the month of Ramadan. Sharia law, there, for example, looks at the statement made by the Prophet Muhammad, who said that paradise is at the foot of mothers, meaning that we should respect our mothers. Right? That's Sharia law. Being good to your neighbor, smiling when you greet someone, this is all part of Sharia law. Right? Now, there are some, you know, legal, what's case law that deals with punishment? What do you call this? What type of law is when someone commits a crime and
criminal law?
There is, an aspect of criminal law involved from traditional Sharia law. For example, grand larceny, for example, under Sharia law could be punished with cutting off someone's hand, right? This is very extreme.
But nobody's asking
but
for
people
that.
Have put forth this idea that Muslims are trying to overthrow the Constitution and replace it with Sharia law. But however, our Constitution in the United States and the laws that we have on books here would never allow, for example, these criminal punishments to be implemented here in the United States. If someone steals, they're going to be put in a court here in the United States, and their punishment will be determined by, you know, the judge and the laws that are on the books.
What about the matrimonial laws? I mean, for example, you know, the woman is somehow subordinate, and the husband can divorce her by some summary proceeding. And take the family assets. Is that part of Sharia law?
Well, actually, there are within Sharia law there is family law that includes, you know, marriage and divorce, custody of children, how your will, you know,
inconsistent with state law. So what happens?
Well, state law basically allows a person to write their will. So if a person writes their will according to how they want their wealth and assets to be divided when they die, they have the right to do so. And some people do that according to, you know, what's dictated by Sharia. Divorce, for example, legally in the United States, has to go through a legal process regardless of, you know, religious traditions that might be followed. Okay.
Same thing with marriage.
A Muslim woman, for example, has the right here in the United States to go to the court to have an attorney and represent her and fight for the rights that the state allows her to do so right here in the United States. But a lot of this legislation is essentially trying to outlaw anything that deals with the Muslim way of life.
It's just anti-Muslim is what it is.
Pretty much. And actually in Oklahoma, this was put on the ballot last November, and actually 70% of the people were in favor of a change in the Oklahoma state constitution that would prohibit judges from considering Sharia law or any other foreign law in their decisions. Right? Our organization, CARE, the Oklahoma chapter, actually immediately filed suit
in federal court to block
the state, the election from being certified and the change of the state constitution.
And
a federal judge issued a permanent injunction based on religious freedom.
Yeah.
A proposed legislation in Tennessee, for example, which thankfully actually has been reworded most recently, but the initial wording of a legislation of a bill in Tennessee actually could have been interpreted practicing Islam, being a Muslim in Tennessee, could be criminally prosecuted with up to 15 years in prison, based on the language in that bill. Like I said, thankfully, though, legislators have backtracked and have reworded and have taken out some of those anti-Islamic wordings and phrases inside that bill.
But the tension continues.
But it was scary. I mean, when you look at it, that hey, if you're a Muslim and you get married according to, you know, Islamic traditional way, you could be put in jail for 15 years. You know.
But doesn't the Muslim community respond to this by saying, "Look, we're just as American as anyone else"?
I mean,
we're patriotic and nothing in Sharia law, nothing in the Muslim religion requires us to not be patriotic. We can be just as patriotic as the next guy, and we are. So, is that kind of like the public response to this?
Sure. I mean, this is certainly the message that, you know, our community and organizations like CARE want to get out. There is a big misconception, a big misunderstanding in the general public that Islam is somehow an imposing political doctrine and not a faith. But I think if one goes back and really studies the history of Islam and looks to, for example, how Muslims ruled Spain, Andalusia, this is a prime role model example of how faiths can live and coexist together very peacefully. You had the Jewish community thriving, Christian community, Muslim community all thriving under Muslim rule. In Spain around the time of just before the time Columbus discovered America,
in many ways the Muslim rule defined Spain as it is today.
Yeah,
you know, even though it's not in control, it was in control for so long.
And that there's actually a verse in the Quran that says there is no compulsion in religion. So, if you do find Muslims who are practicing some way that is imposing and compelling someone to believe in Islam or believe in something else, it's wrong.
Well, is there a national spokesman for CARE? You know, sort of, you're in the state of New Jersey.
I'm the New Jersey chapter, and I speak on behalf of the New Jersey chapter, but we do have a national office in Washington, D.C.
And is there somebody there that speaks on behalf of the entire organization?
And we have a national communications director as well.
Okay. Well, that sounds like, you know, something that will play out in the future.
Yes.
But you still have people like Peter King in congressional hearings. What is going on with him?
Yeah, I mean, last month, Congressman Peter King from Long Island, who is currently the chair of the House Homeland Security Committee in Congress, decided he was going to hold a hearing into the, quote, radicalization of American Muslims and that community's response. And he has put forth this idea that homegrown terrorism is specifically a problem in the American Muslim community, and that most, in his view, of the Muslim community does not cooperate with law enforcement, FBI, when crimes are being investigated. He's made statements in the past that are attributed to him, in which he's said things like, there are too many mosques in this country, you know. So this was very controversial when he announced that he was going to hold these hearings, and when some of the suggested witnesses that he were going to bring forth came out. Actually, our organization CARE immediately went to work to ensure that a lot of these anti-Islamic witnesses or Islamophobes were not allowed to testify. We were able to help get Keith Ellison, for example, a Muslim member of Congress, to be one of the witnesses, and actually it made some news when he did give his testimony and was brought to tears when he talked about how this fellow from New York, a Muslim police officer, responded to 9/11, was killed. He didn't show up to work the next day. And the rumor went out that perhaps he was in cooperation with the terrorists.
In fact, he was killed.
And it wasn't until his remains were found that these rumors were put to rest. Yeah. And in recalling that story, it brought Congressman Keith Ellison to tears. But Peter King decided to hold these hearings, and he essentially singled out American Muslims, saying that the threat of radicalization is essentially coming from this community. But when you focus just on one particular group, if you focus just on American Muslims, and we will admit that there are some elements of radicalization that we need to be concerned about, but if you just focus on us, you're not going to catch those who are going to carry out Columbine.
Right.
You're not going to catch those who went and shot up an American congresswoman in Arizona and killed a federal judge and others. You're not going to get the guy who takes the plane and flies it into the IRS federal building in Texas, right? Or the guy who goes and shoots people at the Holocaust Museum, you know? If you want to look at radicalization and extremism, look at it across the board. But it is, in my view, wrong that you single out one particular community and say that they're the problem. That, in my view, undermines national security.
Well, is the Islamic community doing anything to change this fragmentation to say, look, do not hijack our religion. Do not do violence in the name of our religion. We disown you if you do that. Is there a move to that effect?
Yeah, certainly in terms of the Islamic dictates and Islamic rulings that, you know, American Muslim scholars has put out there condemning terrorism. Yes, that's doing that. And we are also encouraging our community to be vigilant, all right? And our organization, CARE, at the national level, actually in these Peter King hearings, submitted written testimony to the Congress, to these hearings, that showed what the American Muslim community is doing and how we have actually thwarted terrorist attacks planned by Muslims in this country. Something like a third or out of the 120 or so potential terrorist threats that were out there, and something like 48 of them, American Muslims brought information to law enforcement. You know, quick example, the Times Square bombing attempt where someone, a Muslim,
recently
tried to set off a car bomb in the center of Times Square.
Yeah.
First 911 call to go to the police was from an American Muslim. who first one to see that car smoking, called the police, was an American Muslim. In another incident where this guy, two Christmases ago, wanted to try and bring down a plane as a passenger with this underwear bomb, right, that he was supposed to have set off, his own parents had actually contacted American intelligence agencies, warning them that they felt their son was was going down an extremist path. So that actually brings the question, how did this guy even get on a plane? But American Muslims have been instrumental in bringing forth information, and actually one of the witnesses that testified to that in Peter King's hearings was Sheriff Lee Baca, the sheriff of Los Angeles County, who testified that the American Muslim community has been very good, excellent in helping to deter crime and to fight terrorism.
So, James, do you think the tide is turning or will turn, you know, by virtue of your efforts and other people who attempt to impose, civil liberties, in these cases, who attempt to find the true American standard for governing the melting pot, if you will, at this point, at this very interesting point in American history? Is it turning? Is it changing? Will it change? How do you see this going forward?
Yeah, that's another good question. I do see changes within the American Muslim community. No doubt we're on an upward trajectory. I think that all of those who have a negative agenda or a counter agenda to the American Muslim community already know the outcome. I mean, history repeats itself. And every community has gone through its struggles then have eventually attained success. So I think the success for the Muslim community is already written. The outcome is already there, that we will succeed and be, an integral part of shaping America in the future. I think that's said and will be done. So within the community, I see a positive trajectory. But in the short term, what I'm fearing is a lot of this Islamophobia will become, in the near future, a major issue in the upcoming presidential election. And I think candidates are going to jump on this issue with the anti-Sharia laws, Ground Zero Mosque, and again use
as platform positions.
Use security versus civil liberties, saying that if you're not strong on security, you're weak on civil liberties. If you're strong on civil liberties, you're going to be weak on security. I think, and a lot of that's going to point again to those who are advocating for equal treatment of Muslim Americans in this country. And I fear that in the next presidential election, that we'll again see a resurgence of this becoming an election issue. And I don't want to see that happen. No. I mean, in 2008. There were so many people out there trying to characterize Barack Obama as a Muslim in the closet, or a closet Muslim, making reference to his middle name.
They're still looking for a birth certificate.
Yeah. they reference his name, Hussein, Barack Hussein Obama, and all of that. So, I hope America can be more intelligent, more rational in the next election. And that this Islamophobia that we're seeing today, interestingly, 10 years after 9/11, does not become, a major issue in the 2012 election.
Yeah. What about the military? You wonder whether the military has... Maybe the military is just a reflection of what you're talking about. It feeds through. The military only reflects what happens on the political level, but... Maybe also it has its own culture, and I wonder...
It does. The military certainly does have its own culture.
And where that's going. Are there enlightened people now, or are we still stuck in something?
In general, I don't know. I've been out of the military since 2005. I do know that there are still challenges for American Muslims who are serving in the military. I recall in the last year... following a story where a very well-respected, decorated Special Forces soldier was lashed out against, and slurs were written on his door following you know, the tragic shooting by a Muslim officer at Fort Hood last, maybe almost 2 years, maybe more than a year ago now. So I do know that there still are challenges for American Muslims who are serving within the military, but are things changing? I think some things are changing.
Would you urge your child to go in the service or not go in the service?
I would, you know, let my daughter know if she was interested in joining the military. That look, there are unique challenges to being a Muslim and serving in the military, and don't just take what I'm telling you, but you know, do your research. Talk to people who are serving in the military. Talk to those who have served, who have got out, and really understand what you might be getting yourself into. The military is very unique in the sense that you are actually signing a contract of your life when you go into the military. You sign, for the Army, I know, an 8-year military service obligation.
Sure.
And so if you get in the military and you decide that this is not something that is for you, you're at least stuck for 8 years. So it's a big, big commitment. It's not like any other job where you can just decide to quit and change course and find another career. No. So you really have to understand what you're getting into. And that's really what my advice would be.
Yeah. So here you are in Hawaii. What brings you here? I understand it's your first trip to Hawaii.
Actually, it's my second trip to Hawaii. I did spend a leisurely week in Maui back in 2005 during the time I was writing. Mm-hmm. My book. It's my first time in Honolulu and Waikiki, in this area. And I was invited to be the keynote speaker for a banquet hosted by the United States Federal District Court judges. And it was very interesting. I got an opportunity once again to tell my story and how what I went through is very relevant to some of the things going on today, to a room full of legal professionals and judges,
yeah,
attorneys, and lawyers.
Significant room, I'm sure. I'm sorry I couldn't be there. Mm-hmm. But I want to offer you the opportunity to give some final words to the people in Hawaii who weren't there, and the people in Hawaii who maybe don't even know your story.
Yes.
And who are not necessarily sensitive to these issues or particularly concerned about them, because we're in a melting pot all the time anyway. Mm-hmm. But what would you say, would be the takeaway for them to meet you today and to hear what's going on? What would you have them remember you by today? There they are.
Yeah. I mean, I would tell anyone that I meet in Hawaii that that they actually are very blessed to live in a culture and a society here on the island that is very diverse. I mean, that's what I'm all about as a Muslim American, as a chaplain who served in the U.S. military, is diversity. And, you have a very unique culture here that I haven't seen anywhere else in the United States. And, through my travels and being invited to speak in many different places, I find one of the blessings here is that diversity. And all of that actually makes our country better, makes America better. I believe diversity is our greatest strength, and that is something you should always cherish.
And inherent in diversity is tolerance.
Tolerance.
Thank you, James.
Thanks. It's been a pleasure.
Great to have this discussion.
It's been a pleasure.
Thanks for coming down.